Hello, welcome to my second talk today. This time I want to speak about the year 2038 and why that is a big problem even for 64-bit Linux distributions. My name is Thorsten Kuckuck. I'm distinguished engineer at SUSE. I'm leading the future technology team. I'm now since over 25 years with SUSE and far over 28 years open source developer. And the agenda for this talk is, what is the year 2038 problem? How does it look like on 64-bit architectures? And so for this talk, three most important services, LastLock, WTemp, and UTemp. So what is the year 2038 problem? In January 19th, 2038, the 32-bit time T counter will overflow. There is a really, really good Wikipedia article about this. I can only suggest everybody to read that if you are really interested in this topic. And the most important part is there is no universal solution because it's not enough only to enhance the time T type, but you also need to enhance all the on-disk formats and interfaces, API, and a lot of more. So normally, if I speak about this topic, the answers from developers are, it's far, far away. We only support 64-bit architectures until then, which have a 64-bit time T. So why should I care? If you don't care, look at the UTemp header file, and then you will care. We have word time T compat 32-bit, so on all 64-bit architectures, which can also execute 32-bit user land, like x86-64, we use a hard-code 32-bit timer variable for the timer. So even on 64-bit systems, we have a year 2038 problem. For this talk, I looked at UTemp, WTemp, LastLock, and BTemp, so they all belong together. And one solution is, of course, to use 64-bit time T on all architectures. In software, if you recompile everything, is no problem. But this will also change ABI, APIs, on-disk formats. And for LastLock, there is not even an API, so every application implements their own code. So this is a huge amount of work and many, many incompatible situations. So, no, that's not alone the solution. Other ideas were to use the free space in the struct UTemp. So in the past, we did create a buffer in the UTemp struct for enhancements in the future. But this even breaks the ABI and API and on this format. So it's also not really doable. So I started with the most easiest one, LastLock. LastLock formats and prints the content of the dates of the LastLock in, which is written in the varlock LastLock file. So it's a login name, port, and LastLock in time from where you logged in. In the past, only login and SSHD did write these entries, and there was a PEM module, which in OpenSUSE we never really enabled by default. As a result, on my desktop system, last always climbed, I did login in November the year before, because that was the time when I by accident logged in on the console and not via graphical desktop, but clearly that was wrong. And LastLock is a sparse file, so if you have big UIDs, this file looks really big, even if it is a sparse file, because not every file system and not every backup solution could really make it small again, keep it small, but blows up all the zeros written in it. The solution here was to replace LastLock with LastLock 2. This was also done in Ute Linux, so we did it first for OpenSUSE Tumbleweed and MicroS and SLEMicro 6.0. And afterwards, some Red Hat developers contacted me and asked, we want that too. Can we not replace LastLock in Ute Linux with LastLock 2? So now everybody is using NASLog 2, and I'm pretty sure the majority of people didn't even notice the change, because we have a NASLog-compatible NASLog 2 command, which can import the old NASLog data. And yeah, as I said, the majority of people don't even notice that there is another backend now. We now use only the PEM module to collect the data, which means all applications will use it and support it if the PEM module is configured correctly. There's no need to touch any application. The code is only in one place, and it is easy to add changes, which are immediately available for all applications if you update the library. WTemp is also WTemp is using the struct utemp and partly using the same functions as utemp. The WTemp file records all logins, logouts, boot times, and shutdowns. There are other entry types that are not really used anymore today, for example, run levels, because they don't exist with systemd. New time, it's adjust time mix, does read this entry from utemp, but there is no application writing it anymore. And nobody knows who did write that in the past, so we can ignore it. Old time, we haven't found any source code referencing old time. We don't know for what it is good, so we ignore it too. So, and the WTemp format is written by nearly all applications which perform a login. The big problem here is there is no rule when to write a WTemp entry and who should do it. GDM, for example, creates two W entries for login and logout. So if you use last and GDM, then you see more logins, logouts than really happened. Like DBM uses always dev console, and also some few terminal emulators write this data, others do not. So you have inconsistent data. And VTM, for example, with this two WTemp entries, the result is that write or we all these tools don't work correctly there and only create errors. And last is more or less the only application reading this file. LS login also does it as fallback, but it's a case you can ignore. So we use the same code as for NASLog2, so we used an SQLite database. We modified the way how we change it, because last reads all WTemp entries and then tries to match the login and logouts based on the TTY. If you have something like GDM, which always writes dev console, a mapping is not correct and it's more guessing if this is a logout time for this login or not. And with the PEM module, we clearly can state this is a login time, that is a logout time, and it always matches and it's written together in the database. So, and we have, of course, a last compatible command, which also means we switched OpenSUSE, Tumbleweed, and MicroS long time ago, and I would say 99% of the users did not even notice it at all. So, the integration status is OpenSUSE, Tumbleweed, MicroS, and Slim Micro 6.0 switched already to it. Debian added the packages and is discussing it, if they should integrate it, how to integrate it. The GNU/lib developers are discussing if they want to support it, and especially the embedded system distributors were very interested in, and many of them did already adapt to WTempDB and no longer using the old WTemp. Because embedded systems, if you sell them today, it will most likely live far longer than 2038. So for them, it is already today a real problem. But also for Linux distributors, because if you have an enterprise distribution, it will most likely also live longer than 2037. The most interesting and important part was UTemp, because you cannot put it in a PEM module. that easy. You need a service which collects it. So UTEMP is a file which allows to discover information about who is currently using the system. But like WTEMP, there is no common rule who should create which entry at which time. Some terminal emulators create entries, others not. So then you have tools which count the number of logged in users, reporting tools and similar things. It makes the number pretty useless. If somebody starts 3 externs and he's 3 times logged in, if one uses GNOME terminal, then he is not logged in. So doesn't make much sense. The API has now error reporting, and there were design issues which allow a denial of service attack, which is based on locking, that non-privileged users can lock the file and then privileged users can no longer log in. So, and this is only solvable with a daemon, according to everybody who looked at it. Other problems with UTEMP we have is that the struct is pretty awkward. So you have a limit to 32 characters for login names and devices. And if your string is 32 bytes long, characters long, then there is no 0 at the end for termination. If it is shorter, there is a 0 at the end of termination. So the strings are not null terminated in all cases. This means if you, as application, read a struct and then want to access the device or the username, you have to take care and find out at first if there is a null terminated string or if you have to do it at your own. And when I did the research work, most applications are not able to handle this correct. I found many applications which have problems and read behind the string. Luckily, 32-bit long usernames are not that common and device names. And then when we started the discussion, there was also from Luca from Systemd a nice comment on Linux Weekly Net. Why should we limit Linux and ourselves to something only because there was a commercial Unix many, many ages ago and which nobody remembers anymore, so get rid of these limitations. So who uses UTEMP, UTEMPX? UTEMPX is a successor on old Unix systems when they found out that the UTEMP struct is not good enough. On Linux, both is the same in glibc. So the init daemon for process management is using it, but not with systemd, because we don't have run-level and similar things. Applications which write UTEMP entries for others are login, SSHD, XDM, VDM, SDDM, so all the login tools. And the applications who are reading UTEMP entries are WW, WHO, UPTIME, WALL, WRITE. So you can see it's most of the time informing users writing something there. The common usage is count the number of logged in users for your statistics or dashboards so that Grafana can warn if too many users are logged in or whatever. I don't know. But again, XTERM is creating a new UTEMP entry, so every XTERM you start, the system thinks there is a new user. GNOME Terminal does not create such entries. So if you open 3 externs, 3 people are logged in. If you only open GNOME Terminal, no person is logged in, doesn't also make much sense. And most tools are only use this information to show information about the logged in users, the WHO and W. And you can send wall messages to all logged in users like this team is shutting down. But if you look at GNOME Terminal or GNOME, if they don't write an UTEMP entry, then they don't get the message. So for desktop users, there is still no real solution because I learned they don't care really about this. So I ignored this part because I'm not the desktop developer. The solution everybody agrees on is that we need a daemon with extra library. Such implementations exist already today, like UTEMPS. It solves the 32-bit time T problems. It solves the security problems. But the API design problems are not solved. The function calls and return values, access of the struct is not solved. All applications need to review if they can handle it as 64-bit time T and not some lazy old code is there who is using only an int. And you have yet another daemon running on the system. So that would be a huge amount of work to adopt all applications and review them. Looking forward, we found systemd log-in-d. It's used already on all systemd-based distributions. It's mature and so hopefully secure. It collects already all necessary data. And you can access this data with log-in-ctl or dbus or libsystemd. So we have three interfaces. So systemd version 254 is needed because that is when all of my enhancements and changes were accepted. So the mapping struct between struct utemp and logind is quite simple. Uttype, only user process is available, so we can ignore it. For pit, line, so the TTY, session ID, user, we have functions from libsystemd you can use. Utexit and utsession, I haven't found anything who is using that. The time, of course, the SC session gets start time, and the field for an IP6 address, if you have one, and not IP4, doesn't matter because SC session get remote host solves this already all for you. No need to handle it separate. So with struct utemp to read all entries, it's a while loop with our error handling. With libsystemd, it's a little bit more code, but it's also quite simple, and you can add error handling to it quite easily. So it's easy to convert the struct with a loop is nearly similar. So we made this last year. So the upstream status is very good. I only listed the core packages here, else I would need two or three slides to list all the projects where we did submit patches, and I think from all the projects, only two did not accept patches. One is a Python project where the maintainer says 2038 is too far away, he does not want to bother with it today, and OpenSSH is the other problem. There's an open pull request. The systemd developers, some other open source Linux distributor developers, they all tried to help me to get it upstream, but the upstream maintainers are not interested, so it's that. PROC-PSNG, Fedora systemd, Util Linux, Core Utils, they all done, it's all upstream, and yeah. The funny thing about Core Utils is, when we as OpenSUSE maintainers contacted them, they were not interested. Then Debian told them they have a problem with their next distribution version because of the year 2038, and then suddenly overnight they implemented what we asked them for. So, what about screen script sudo xterm? These are the terminal emulators or tools which create additional utemp entries. The background that they do it is they wanted to get the warning messages that the user sees them. So on all XTM consoles, you should see these warning messages. But in the end, people are annoyed if they have 10 virtual consoles and they then get 10 messages, your system is shut down. They want a better solution from the desktop environment. They said this is something which is still open, but it looks like that nobody has a problem with it because it's not working since, I think, 9 months now, and nobody until now complained or, yeah. Maybe because in the past it did already not really work because most display managers also brought broken utemp entries and well, it never worked for them. So the question is, should they create a log-in D session or not? Terminals are now new session. It was a hack to get warning messages, so they should not write. And PEMSystemd will not create a new session for sudo defe, so that problem was solved with that too. If people think they need a login D session, then they need to adjust their application to call the PEMSystemd module. Okay, These are a lot of my blog and GitHub repositories with code, patches, and more information, and also a long list of applications which we adjusted or where no change is necessary as a reference. And so, as I said, OpenSUSE, Tumbleweed, MicroS, SLE, leap6.0, and now also leap-micro all use already systemd logind, wtempdb, and lastlog2. None of them is using anymore the run utemp or var log wtemp file. And if I look at Baxilla on the mailing list, I have the impression that we made a good job there because I don't see any complaints. It just seems to work for the people. So that was it already. Are there questions about this? No questions.
Thank you. Do you consider handling all these low-level components sufficient, or should there be tested, for example, databases if they handle it correctly? That could be like a critical application for that.
And what exactly do you mean if we...
If, for example, some database application like Postgres could have also problems with the dates.
So there are many applications which have problems with the year 2038. I don't know about Postgres SQL. I know, for example, MariaDB has, and there's also a bug report in Baxilla. So the MariaDB people, we are not interested because it's far, far away. And so... Yes, nothing we can do. We can only hope that only the code has some wrong effects, whatever, and that not the on this format is incompatible. We also know about a lot of applications who did bad coding style, like the printf. If you use time t on 64-bit and on 32-bit, it's different types. One is 64-bit, another is 32-bit. But there is now, for printf, no character for, this is a time t, but only for int or long. So many applications casting the 64-bit time t to 32-bit, so that the compiler happily compiles and does not warn that the print template is wrong. So I only looked at utemp, wtemp, lastlog, because that was something you need to solve about many different applications to adjust them. I did not do a review of every single application out there if they are fine. Quite the opposite. I'm expecting that in the next years we will see or find many, many problems in many, many applications where we have to adjust the code. And I hope that this is not really then ABIs which get broken, but it is more easily. So for 32-bit libraries, there is this time 64-bit switch, so that even on 32-bit systems, 32-bit applications can use 64-bit time T with current Philips C. This is other problems because it very often breaks the ABI. We had this now with Ute Linux, where I was able to find a solution that a function exists twice, one with 64-bit and one with 32-bit, and with sample versioning, we try to make sure that the linker is choosing the right one. So I expect many problems in this regard still in the next years. This is only one problem which was where many, many applications was affected by. That is not all problems.
So if the question is if SP6 is ready, you would say like basically yes, but there is still some follow-up work to be done on particular applications.
SLES 15 will never be year 2038 ready. Alone because of all the 32-bit code it still has. The 32-bit applications we have today will stop working in 2038. You need to recompile them with the 64-bit time T. And not only that, you also need to fix all libraries, adjust it, and so on. So no way for SLE 15 to survive 2038. For SLES 16, yes, we need to increase our QI to check if applications are really 2030 Act ready, but since these are most of the time application local fixes changes you need to do, we can change that with or solve it with a maintenance update in most cases, I hope. And come opposite to this, such a change you cannot do with a maintenance update because it's affecting too much.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, we have still 4 minutes. We manage more questions too, if wanted.
Indeed, again, between the talks.
What was the reason that the open SSH patches were not accepted? I mean, the pull request. You mentioned that it wasn't accepted.
Because BSD will not use SDMD.
Okay, but so this was only related to systemd, but not something open SSH specific. I mean, the pull request for open SSH wasn't related to open SSH or what?
Now, so open SSH creates the UTEMP entries and yes. It works with them. And open SSH does not start the PEM stack with a TTY. It only creates a TTY later.
Ah, okay.
So in all modules, you don't have a TTY in OpenSSH, but a fake string. The patch is doing nothing else than at the end, when we have the TTY, sending this TTY to logind so that logind can update the entry for this login with the correct TTY. And that was rejected because they don't see a sense from it, they don't want more dependencies, they don't want to derate more from upstream. They didn't really clearly state why they don't like it. So the systemd developers discussed this with them again. I know from Leonard, he told me he discussed it with him already 3, 4, 5 years ago, but now it's a wall from the OpenSSH manager we are not able to break. So they say still no.
Okay, what I have heard about the BSDs is that they will not care, at least for free BSD, I read this, they will not care about 32-bit systems in general from free BSD 15 onwards. So I guess they only care about the 64-bit C library, and probably that's also maybe a reason that they don't care about OpenSSH. I know it comes from OpenBSD originally, but maybe they have a similar attitude towards that.
So if you have a distribution which is pure 64-bit and not BArch, then you don't have these problems.
Okay.
And the BSD people have all 64-bit in their UTEMP. They don't have 32-bit like on Linux vLibc, so they don't have that problem.
Ah, okay.
And so they are not interested in changing anything because they don't have the need.
All right. So thanks for your explanation.
Okay. Then thank you for listening. And I hope the thunderstorm coming now will not disturb you from going home later today. Thank you.